asking the police just for a few moments, maybe one or two moments. So try to stay local, but make sure everybody feels welcomed and recognized, and introduce yourselves if you need to. All right, go for it. Right after that, the very next day is Ash Wednesday. So you'll see posted, there's posters around. We're going to be doing ashes to go in multiple places. And then there's an ecumenical Ash Wednesday service. If you want to be in the choir, it's going to be a really good choir because there's going to be a lot of voices. So if you love singing, this is the chance to come sing together. The rehearsal's at 5 o'clock at the Brown Church, and then the worship service begins at 6:30 at the Brown Church, and it will be led by any clergy. But we tend to keep it light, lots of reflections and lots of interactive stuff, so it should be a good and a meaningful opportunity to gather and begin Lent together. Those are the announcements that I can think of right now. Anything else that anybody wants to add? Meg?
Yes, the calendar in Fellowship Hall is pretty blank. We have lots of opportunities for people to host coffee hour. You'll see today's is has been put together quickly by some dedicated folks, but if you're looking for a really luscious coffee hour or you want to do it yourself, we'd really appreciate people signing up for that. Many open. And also, if you are interested in greeting or being the reader at any Sunday service, there are lots of blanks on that calendar, too. And please do not necessarily wait until someone asks you. We're very happy to have you sign up on your own.
All right, so feel free to sign yourself up to the calendar. And Arden?
Greg and I are helping with a service dog. We have a two-year-old sweetheart. Her name is Joy. And I got to bring her in today. Our job is to acclimate her to social situations. She's very good already to sit and, you know, all those different things. But social situations is what she needs. Service dogs, it's very hard, but you are not supposed to pet her. She's beautiful, and I don't want to. But that's the way it is. So I just wanted to give you a forewarning. I'm not sure she may be. She is 2 years old. That translates in dog years to teenage, and we don't know which teenage is. So I'm not sure, but I'm going to try it.
All right, so there's going to be a service dog coming in. Arden's going to bring her in. And we've been asked to enjoy her from a distance and not pet her because she's learning to be in social situations and not try to seek out help. She's supposed to be attending to the person that she's dedicated to. Any other announcements? Well, then. Welcome to Jackson Community Church, and this is our Sunday to enjoy Mardi Gras festivities. So Heather Pearson has come to join us today and is offering some special jazz music for us. And this is just to kind of get us in the mood for Tuesday, whether you're going to hear Heather or whether you're coming to eat with us or doing both because you're ambitious. Enjoy today and welcome. Thank you. joining me now in the call worship, and thank you for that. Blessed are you, God of all creation, for your goodness graces us with this opportunity to celebrate. As we savor your abundance, shared through the fruitfulness of a fertile earth and the labor of many hands, we are mindful of an environment that groans, even as she gives birth to life, and people who do not have access to this bounty and plenitude. As we share wonderful gifts today, we commit ourselves to greater awareness of a world and her creatures, her children, who need our support. Tasting the fullness of what we have today, let us welcome hunger, heightened consciousness in the season to come.
Pray us for your word and your call.
As we sing the hymns of gratitude, so may abstinence call out a place for deeper desires and attentiveness to your world and your people. May self-discipline turn our hearts to you and give us new freedom for service to others. May we create a place for your voice, your presence, deep in our lives. Now is that time in the service when we raise up out loud prayers of concern and celebration and gratitude. We will also hold a moment of silence, and we will conclude with the Lord's Prayer. I offer you first a few prayers that have come from various places. In particular, we will be praying today for people who have been diagnosed with cancer, are living with cancer, or who are on a hospice vigil due to cancer. We think of Seal, for whom we have prayed, and who has both flourished and is now on hospice, living with cancer. We think of two other people who are currently undergoing treatment, Heidi and Lori, who were raised up in prayer at 8 o'clock. And today I now have permission to say that Cheryl Kaiser is living with cancer. She has stage 2 breast cancer. It's already been diagnosed. She'll begin chemo on Thursday. She will also be undergoing radiation and surgery. This is at least a 4-month journey. And she and Tom welcome calls and cards. They prefer right now not visits until they say that they're ready for that. They still have a lot of medical appointments to undergo. And then, of course, her immune system will be compromised in cycles of 3 weeks. Their daughter is with them right now. Their son was up earlier, and she's been with them already 2 weeks and will be remaining with them for a while longer. So she's been cooking and taking care of Ari and their dog. So at the moment they're in good hands, they'll let us know when they're ready to welcome meals. They promise us they're not shy about saying yes. It's just not quite time for that yet. So we will get a chance to surround them with our love. But for now, please hold them up with light, with love, and prayers for healing. This is what they've really asked for, is our prayers. And these are the prayers that we extend to every person in this congregation and in our wider community who lives with these challenging diagnoses. There are people who are quietly living with it, who are not telling you about their journey. Others that are now in remission or having a good run while on treatment. It's a challenging journey. It's a long journey. And it touches all of us. We think also of those who are living with other forms of life-changing or life-limiting conditions. We think of people who are caregivers of or living with some kind of Alzheimer's or cognitive change. We think of people that continue to live with mental health challenges and flourish and are resilient with them or are now in crisis. We think of people who have challenges in one specific part of their body, their hearts, their lungs, their bones, their brains. There are so many parts of our bodies that are vulnerable. And many of us need prayers for really specific parts of ourselves. And we think also of those who offer the medical treatment and accompany us on these journeys. Please, lives of those around you who are touched by these changes. And know that your love and your presence is the greatest gift that you can give. Other prayers. Kevin?
Yeah, prayer for all the reverends and pastors who do so much to help people. And prayers for the first responders, the police, the firemen, the EMTs, even the doctors and nurses at hospitals who care so much about people and do so much. And I know Reverend Gail is going to be a glorified saint someday. And I'm grateful for every breath I take. It's a gift from God. And it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog.
So prayers of gratitude for our first responders, for those who take care of us in so many different ways, spiritually, physically. Meg?
I'd like to just pray for the family and friends of Janet Green, who passed away a couple weeks ago. Most of you probably don't remember Janet, but because she had very long struggle with Alzheimer's and has been in nursing home for a very long time. But she was an active member of the church when I first came to Jackson, involved with the Girl Scouts, involved. She was the first president of the Historical Society. She was in our choir every Sunday. She was on the Protestant Chapel Association in many, many things.
So we give thanks for the life of Janet Green, and we remember her and we honor her. Other prayers. Prayers of gratitude or celebration today.
Gratitude for the opportunity to be in a country where we can participate in the upcoming town meetings.
Gratitude for living in a country where we have voices and votes and presence in the upcoming town meetings. Sandra?
Gratitude for the open eye prayer that I had this morning when I was walking my dog on this beautiful day without wind and blue sky and sun and smoke from people's lip stoves and the sound of the train whistles.
The sound of the ski train and the sunlight and the open eye prayer of being out in the world today and reveling in it. Any other prayers, Kevin?
We're grateful for this church, for the way station, for all the people that volunteer at the way station. All the people who support me and all my friends, and to live in New Hampshire, it's a beautiful state.
Gratitude for New Hampshire and all those who support Kevin. And I believe earlier you said for every birthday cake.
Yeah.
Other prayers?
I just wanted to express gratitude for the family that I mentioned to ask in a row. Fire. There's a two families that were affected. Gail survived, and fine as far as I know. One of them goes to all around. And it was only the back of their house that was damaged, but the neighboring house was pretty much destroyed. But the people are fine, and they gave a lot of help and very grateful. I want to express gratitude for that.
Gratitude for the community that surrounds the families that lost their housing to a fire. It was a fat man, right?
Yeah.
Pastor Hilda. I'm
not to embarrass you, but gratitude to who is spearheading this Mardi Gras celebration and putting everybody into line to do this.
Gratitude for Elite Chef and the upcoming cuisine and all of
what my special is.
She more chill prayers that came out of your ears, so you know it's going to happen based on Sue's earrings. It's like a weather report. Other prayers. Then let us pray. Oh, Holy God, today is a day to be reminded that we are called to be children of delight, that we are called to praise you and to revel in the abundance of this world and find reasons to give thanks and to sow the seeds of happiness and resilience and gratitude in our lives and the lives of others. Let the music, let the food, let the reflections, and simply this gathering of people be a reminder that we are fashioned for delight and joy, and that this is the gift you give us to shine a light, to lift us up when we are weighed down by challenges. We are yours. We give ourselves to you. Hear now our silence. Hear us as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. We are really, really good.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The reading today comes from Isaiah 25, verses 6 to 9. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines framed clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces and the disgrace of his people. He will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Luke 14, verses 7 to 14. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. Give this person your place, and then in disgrace you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, Friend, cook higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, or your brothers, or your relatives, and or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return, and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous.
Well, I have here some utensils with which I need some help.
Do I have any volunteers to help with the utensils? Like me? Okay, she is willing to get up. Lawrence, do you want to come help me with the utensils?
We're going to do a little science experiment, okay? Now, I think we're going to have Nora do this. All right, so Nora, let's see. If we pretend that this is a soup bowl, you're going to take this. Now, see if you could dip that spoon in there and could you get it to your mouth? You can sort of get it to your mouth, but it's kind of long. All right. Now, let's imagine it's twice as long. So if it was twice as long, do you think you could get it to your mouth? All right, that wouldn't work very well. So what if we all lived in a place where we couldn't ask for anything? We couldn't serve ourselves any kind of food or drink. And let's say that Gia and Nora are both sitting at the same table. Okay, so Gia, you have to pretend that those are twice as long. See if you could get something like twice as long. I'm sorry, it's pretty longer. To your mouth. Could you get it to your mouth if it was like that long? See, pretend. No, you couldn't. Okay, so how the heck would they eat a meal? They've got these utensils that are really long. They're not allowed to ask for any help. How could we problem solve this? Do you guys have any ideas? What's that?
Eat each other.
What? Eat each other? Oh, so maybe you could take your long utensil, all right, and you could dip it in there. And you think you could reach Nora? Oh, you guys could probably help each other. All right, I like this. Problem solving. All right, why don't you hand me that bow? And thank you. That was the demonstration for today. So what Nora and Gia just demonstrated is something that we call an agape meal. I've talked about this at least once before here, but has anybody ever attended an agape meal? I know at least one person has attended an agape meal. An agape meal is where you all sit down together and there's plenty of food at the table, but it's not like when we do our brunch church and you take your own plate up and you get to fill it up with whatever looks good and you go back and we all sit down and eat. An agape meal requires that you don't ask for anything, and that the people around you remember to serve you food, drink, everything. It is an act of love because you are not thinking about yourself, you are thinking about others. But like everything else, this is a spiritual practice and it requires some rehearsal. And so sometimes when you attend an agape meal, people start chatting and they're eating. And then at the end, when you start to talk about it, can you imagine what might have happened? What might have happened at an agape meal? Empty plates? Because somebody forgot to ask their neighbor if they needed anything, and the instruction is you can't ask for anything. Or let's say you drink all your water, but you're really, really thirsty, and your glass stays empty. Somebody forgets you. Or the opposite could happen, right? You could have plenty of food because people keep thinking of you, yes? The agape meal is a learning experience. We, at the end of the meal, we talk about, what's your experience like? Did you have enough? Did you have enough of everything? Did you run out of something? Is there someone that you remember or someone that you forgot? What did you learn by sitting together and depending on somebody else to feed you?
scriptures are about abundance. And this music that Heather is playing and the song that we're going to sing together when Alan is playing for us and our pop-up choir helps lead us is about abundance. And even Fat Tuesday is actually all about abundance. It's called, Mardi Gras translates into Fat Tuesday. And the reason that we celebrate Fat Tuesday is because we're coming out of traditions where people were preparing for a period of self-discipline and abstinence and fasting. They would eat a more lean diet. And so rather than waste the things that were in their larder and in their cupboard, everybody cooks it all up and they have a big feast the night before we begin the fasting. So we get donuts and pancakes and we get jambalaya and gumbo and all kinds of delicious things. And whole traditions and festivals and parties have grown out of this tradition of using up everything abundant that you have, everything rich and delicious that you have in preparation for a time where you choose not to eat so richly. You choose to simplify your life and create some space for other ways of thinking and being. But the beauty of Mardi Gras and the beauty of the passages that we just heard is that we are reminded that we are indeed fashioned for delight. We are fashioned for joy. That when we are slammed with bad news, when we are trying to hold up a community that is living with cancer, with challenges to their hearts and their lungs, when people are living with depression and suicidality or altered consciousnesses and Alzheimer's, with long, chronic challenges, this is precisely when we need a reason to celebrate. We need a reason to be grateful. We need to see the world around us in all of its brilliance and its color and give thanks for every day that gets a little bit longer as the winter transitions into spring, and give thanks for every breath that we get to breathe, or find a way to look at each other and serve each other what we cannot give to ourselves, because sometimes we can't even ask. We are invited to an agape feast, to focus on joy and abundance and use up all the goodness around us, because really the promise of the love that we come here to celebrate is there will never be an end to the love that we need. There will always be enough. We are enough and more than enough, and the love that we need in order to give us fuel and renewal is always present to us. So if we live our lives as if we are living an agape feast, and we focus on others, we don't need to worry that we're going to run out of the energy and the resilience and the resources that we need, because it is here in this community, in our connection to each other, our connection to holiness and creation. It is all right here. Abundance is always within reach. And yes, Lent will give us chances to simplify, to be introspective, to give something up or give something away or give to something, to be thoughtful in so many different ways. But Fat Tuesday helps us remember that we are also supposed to be glad and joyful, and that you can do both. You can enter Lent and think about ways that you need to be more aware of the world and attentive to it, and yet always, always be searching for joy. For the painted bunting that everybody still keeps going to visit at Tin Mountain. For that glimpse of color and hope that helps you be renewed and balanced and not tip over into despair or be overwhelmed by circumstances, but have perspective, find things to be grateful for, and find one way to go one more day together through this world, because there is enough when we let each other love each other. This is the beauty of Fat Tuesday. Thanks be to God. For the abundance that has come into your lives, we ask that you too will be generous with this church, and we will in turn be generous where we are asked to give love and tangible support, whether it goes to this valley or other parts of this world. We give you thanks. of holy love, source of all that is given to us, all that flows through us, we ask that these gifts of love will flow through our hands into this valley and into the world, just as we are called out of this place to be present where we are most needed, and to open ourselves to be love as we are called to give love. In your name we pray. Amen. So friends, when the saints go marching in, so anybody that practiced this morning, did anybody practice this morning? Not really? Do you want to be a song leader? Or you're playing, right? Oh, you're doing it together, so now, okay. All right, well then we're going to give it a whirl. Minus five. Oh, good, we have some volunteer song leaders coming forward. So you'll find the words inside your bulletin. We chose the chapel verses. And we're going to get it all as we can, right? This is a happy day. We want to be as jazzy as we can be.
Thank you.